Hello, welcome to the Community Broadband University Series. My name is Stephen Colby. I'm with Corning's Engineering Services Department. And in this episode, we're going to talk about the main types of cable installation methods. So to do this, we're going to break it down into two categories. First one being aerial installation, and then we'll move on to underground installation. So starting with aerial installation. So the first thing to realize is that most cables cannot support themselves from pole to pole. They need to be attached to something else. So historically, how this is done is that a steel messenger strand is attached in tension between the two poles, and then the cable is then lashed to that strand. So let's, for example, say that this piece of tubing is my fiber optic cable, and this threaded rod is my messenger strand that's tensioned between the poles. I'll temporarily support the cable along the strand, then I'll take a lashing machine which clamps over both of them, and as I pull the lashing machine along, the lashing machine rotates, wrapping one or more lashing wires around the two components, securing them together. Now let's say I'm a company that already has existing cables in the aerial plant. Ideally, if I'm putting up a new fiber optic cable, I would like to just lash, or in this case, overlash that new cable to the existing cable bundle that's already up there. In that case, it's very similar. So you have the existing bundle, temporarily hang your new cable, put the lashing machine over the bundle and the new cable, and lash them together. But let's say you're a company that does not have an existing cable or bundle of cables that you can overlash to, and you do not want the expense of installing a brand new messenger strand and have that two-step process. So there's the cost of the new messenger strand and then the cost of step two to lash the cable to it. So there's another category of cables that we refer to as ADSS, all dielectric self-supporting cables. As the self-support implies, these types of cables can be hung from pole to pole and support their own weight. The AD, all dielectric part, means that within the cable there are no metallic elements, so that helps reduce the weight of the cable, but also has the benefit of making it more lightning resistant. So with the advantages of ADSS cable, there is one disadvantage, and that's in the future, if you wanted to install another fiber optic cable, you cannot overlash that to the existing ADSS cable. And the reason for that is because ADSS cables are designed to only support their own weight plus environmental loading like wind and ice. So if you do want the option of overlashing more cables in the future, then the last category of cables we'll talk about here are figure eight cables. So that's when the manufacturer takes a standard fiber optic cable and takes standard stranded messenger, and in the factory, we extrude a jacket over both of them to make one component. And when you look at the cross section at the end, it kind of looks like a figure eight, and so hence the name figure eight cables. So with this type of cable, it's a one-step process to put up the strand and the cable between the poles, one step, and so it can reduce your cost of the alternate method of first putting up the new strand and coming back with a second step to lash the cable to it. So those are the basic types of aerial installation. We'll move on to underground installation now. And for this, we'll break it down into two categories, and that's direct buried and installation of cables in conduit. So for direct buried, so first of all, many cables are capable of being direct buried in the ground. However, most manufacturers are going to recommend that you add one or more layers of armoring on the cable. And this can be done. Many cable types have that option to add the armoring layer. And what that does for you, the armoring increases the crush protection of the cable, and also helps protect the cable against rodents who may be burrowing in the ground and come across your cable and want to gnaw on it. So probably the one big exception that you'll see out there to armoring is with fiber optic drop cables in a fiber to the home application. So oftentimes those fiber optic single fiber or dual fiber drop cables from the street to the home are not armored, but they're robust enough to be able to be direct buried in the customer's yard. The main point though is that if you're going to direct bury a cable, contact the manufacturer, get the spec sheet for that cable, and verify that that cable design is recommended for direct buried applications. So now let's say you have a cable, it's good for direct buried, so how do you actually get it in the ground? Well, there are three main installation methods. They are trenching, plowing, and directional drilling. So we'll start with trenching. So as the name implies, trenching means you're opening up a trench in the ground and you're gonna place your cable in it and then backfill over the cable to close up the trench. You can do this. There are many types of trenching machines that work well, you know, can make the trench fairly quickly and of different widths. But you could also do the trench, for example, with a backhoe. So why would you want to use an open trench? Well, a good reason for that is if you have to put many cables in the ground. So let's say you're in a feeder part of your network or the main distribution part where you're running many cables together until they get to the point where they branch off and go their individual directions. It may be more convenient to have an open trench to place all those cables in at once. The next method we'll talk about is plowing. So in plowing, there's a plow blade that's attached to a tractor, and as the tractor moves along, the plow blade is ripping a seam in the earth and placing the cable in that seam. So the cable reel is attached to the tractor, the cable comes off, goes down a chute in the plow blade, and exits the bottom of the plow blade at the required depth. So there are different plow blades depending on the depth you want to install the cable at, you know, 3 feet, 4 feet, 5 feet. And the plow blades also are based on the diameter of the cable that you're trying to install, at least the range of cables. So the kind of the neat thing about the plow blade, because it's very narrow, ripping that seam in the earth, as it goes through and pays off the cable, the earth behind the blade just kind of folds up and fills in that seam naturally. A lot of plow blades also have a vibratory device attached that vibrates the plow, which makes it easier to move along as it's ripping that seam, but that vibration also helps the seam to close in behind it. All this means that the surface restoration you have to do in the ground is usually very minimal with plowing versus open trench where there's typically a lot of restoration that needs to occur. Also with plowing would be the preferred method by most contractors if you have very long distances to go with very few obstacles in the way. The third type of underground installation for direct buried would be directional drilling, or you'll hear it referred to as HDD, horizontal directional drilling. And so for example, if you have a street that you have to cross, I mean, you can't plow across a paved or concrete street, and doing an open trench would be very disruptive, time-consuming, and expensive to repair the street once you're finished. And so that's where directional drilling comes in, where you drill a path under the street. However, directional drilling can also be used for long straight line distances. And say your pathway is along the road, the side of the road parallel to the street, but there are many side streets and driveways that you have to come across that may make it impractical to use plowing. And so with directional drilling, you could do a long bore shot along that, passing under all the obstacles. And there's a lot to understand and about directional drilling and for the crews to do it well, but at a high level, you're drilling the bore, and then you're pulling back the cable through that bore that you drilled. All right, so that's direct buried cables in the ground by plowing, trenching, and directional drilling. So the last thing we'll touch on is conduit installation. So if a company already has an open conduit in the ground that's in good shape, and it's along the pathway where they want to install the cable, then that's gonna be, you know, one of the first choices to use. So a good conduit system, installing a cable in a good conduit system can be as quick and as inexpensive as installing an aerial cable in an overlash situation. So why would you want a conduit? So let's say you don't have the conduit system in place, and actually it's highly unlikely. If you're putting in a new system, unless it's a long haul, it's probably unlikely that you have available conduits going everywhere that you need, and then you have to make the decision of, you know, do I want to install new conduits? So what would help you make that decision? Well, first of all, conduits do provide a great crush protection and rodent resistance for the cable inside. So you do not need to have an armored cable going in a conduit. So you could reduce the price of your fiber optic cable by specifying a non-armored cable. But another big advantage of having a conduit is that once you have that pathway forever. So a big example would be is if the cable gets damaged in the future, a cable cut, for example, and you want to replace a section of cable, with a conduit system, you have the option of pulling out that damaged cable and pulling in a new cable. Unlike in a direct buried scenario, the cable is encased, encapsulated by the earth. You can't go back to the nearest handhole or manhole and try to pull out a direct buried cable. It won't budge. So that's a big advantage of using a conduit system. And then the last thing we'll talk about, all right, so you have your conduit, but how do I get the cable in that conduit? The main method that the people have used for years is pulling the cable. So conduits, you can get them with a pull line already installed. If there's not one in there, it's easy enough to install a pull line. But you'll take that, your fiber optic cable, there'll be a pulling grip that gets attached to the end of the cable, and to that, a breakaway swivel that you'll attach the pull line to. The swivel prevents the cable from rotating and getting damaged as it's being pulled in, and the breakaway part will cause it to separate if the tension on the cable is higher than the cable's tensile rating, thereby protecting the cable from damage. Other than pulling in a cable, a very common method over the past many years has been using compressed air to install a cable. So that's using the compressed air plus a machine that's pushing the cable to basically float the cable into the conduit. And an experienced crew doing this can get very, very long distances, so it's a very viable installation technique. You'll hear it often referred to as cable jetting or cable blowing. Technically, there is a difference between jetting and blowing, but a lot of people just use the terms interchangeably. The main thing to know is that if you hear jetting or blowing, it's about installing a cable using compressed air instead of pulling the cable into the conduit. So there you have it. So those are a quick overview of the basic cable installation methods, both aerial and underground. Naturally, there's a lot more detail that goes into all of these methods, and for a crew to be able to do these really well without damaging the cable. But here at Corning, we have lots of resources. We have standard recommended procedures for these different methods, and we have our technical staff that can support you. So if you could fill out the contact information below on this page, and we'll get back to you. So that's it for this episode. Thanks for watching.